meeting, I'd like to call your attention to the starting of our Cape Cod Commission meeting, June 7th, 2012. Thank you all for attending. I would, as we are down a chairman and secretary clerk, I will be filling in for the chairman today. My name is Michael Blanton, and I am going to call upon my distinguished colleague from Sandwich, the minority representative, John Harris, to call the roll.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Barnstable, Rorden Richardson. Bourne, Michael Blanton.
Present.
Brewster, Elizabeth Taylor. Chatham, vacant. Dennis, Richard Roy.
Present.
Easton, Shore Brookshire.
Yeah.
Harwich, Robert Bradley.
Here.
Mashpee, Ernest Virgilio. Orleans, Leonard Short.
Here.
Provincetown, Austin Knight.
Here.
Sandwich, Joanne O'Keefe.
Present.
Truro, Peter Graham. Wellfleet, Roger Putnam.
Here.
Yarmouth, John McCormick.
Here.
County Commissioner, Mary Pat Flynn.
Here.
Minority Representative John Harris is here. Governor's appointee, Herb Olson.
Here.
Mr. Chairman, we have quorum.
Thank you very much, Mr. Harris. At this point in time, I would like to ask members of the public if there is anything that is not on our agenda to be discussed today, this would be the time for you to come to the podium and make public comment. And seeing how we do not have any members of the public wishing to address us at this time, I will ask the Executive Director for your report.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just want to inform the members that our meetings with boards of selectmen are underway over the last couple of months, and so we've hit 11 out of the 15 so far. In addition to that, in order to try to facilitate some public communication around the wastewater issue, we have been having Saturday meetings in the 15 towns. We try to do two towns every Saturday, and so we have eight towns done, and we'll be finished with that by July 15th. So between myself and Andrew Gottlieb, the executive director of the Cape Cod Water Protection Collaborative, we've actually hit the towns 45 times in about the last 3 months. In an effort to make sure that everybody has access and has any questions they have about wastewater or watershed issues answered. Additionally, we unveiled at the Smarter Cape Summit a couple of weeks ago our Watershed MVP application. It's a piece of software we've developed here at the Cape Cod Commission. MVP stands for Multivariate Planner, and it is sort of a wastewater planning tool that we believe will help expedite discussions around that important issue on the local level. Had an opportunity to preview that for both EPA and DEP this week. And EPA is working on a model of their own that is much higher level, less granular than ours. It's a triple bottom line model in the Narragansett Bay watershed. And so we showed them our model, we talked about theirs, and they have agreed to collaborate with us at their cost to develop the same type of model for Cape Cod. So we have both of these models that will be moving forward and on parallel tracks over the next 3 to 6 months. Also on wastewater, and finally, just in case you hadn't heard, the parties in the lawsuit, Conservation Law Foundation, Buzzards Bay Coalition versus the Environmental Protection Agency, announced several weeks ago to Judge Wolf that they were unable to reach agreement on settlement. And so they have filed a notice with the court and will begin formal litigation proceedings soon. So we keep an eye on that. And then finally, our the e-permitting grant that we were awarded in conjunction with 14 of the 15 towns is underway. We've actually been granted or in the process of being granted an extension on that. The state timelines were a little bit tight. So with any luck, we'll have through next April to sort of get that e-permitting program up and running alongside the Watershed MVP and some of the other applications they're working on as part of our Strategic Information Office, working with the county on their regional umbrella services system. So a lot of information over the next 12 months and a lot more about wastewater. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Executive Director. Our next order of business, we do have two sets of minutes. I'm sorry. Question, Ms. O'Keefe?
Can I sign the Executive Director's report?
I can allow that.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Jack. Thank you, Mr. Executive Director. I just wanted to say that you were at the town of Sandwich, and the feedback that I got was terrific, and I wanted to, just so that it's part of the minutes, to say thank you to you and your staff to take 8 Saturdays off, which I think are precious time, and I think we should acknowledge that. So that's just what I wanted to say, and thank you,
well, thank you.
Chair.
I would like to thank my staff because it wasn't their idea.
I see other members, Mr. McCormick and then Mr. Knight.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just wanted to compliment the Executive Director for the meeting with the Yarmouth Selectmen. I think he was on the agenda supposedly for 20 minutes, and the meeting went, his section of the meeting went well over an hour, and speaking to the Selectmen after the meeting, they thought it was very productive and informative. And I think it was only a week after that he had the Saturday meeting in Yarmouth for the to answer questions about wastewater. I thought he should be complimented on that. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. To the Executive Director, is there a timeline on this suit? Do we have any idea of timing? Because now they've lost one part, and not lost, but one part's moving to another, actually. So is there any estimates of timing?
No, they filed some papers with the court to set out a time frame. I think some of the early sort of responses are due by the end of the month into July, but it's, you know, these extensions sort of go on forever. You never know how this is going to go, but I don't think there'll be any resolution on the suit short of, 12 or 18 months from now, unless their settlement discussions start up again. But I don't foresee that happening at this point, and I think I just underline that by saying that I think that that's bad news for the Cape. I think the settlement carried with it the promise of compromise and a little bit more time and flexibility for us to arrive at a solution on our own. And in a full-blown adversarial process, you know, I can only see two outcomes. One, CLF wins, and we wind up with federal permits on the Cape and a capital construction program consistent with what we've seen from the federal permitting process of the last 35 years, which is something that's overbuilt, big pipe, and completely unaffordable, in my opinion. And if CLF loses, especially with some of what we've seen on the local scenes over the last couple of months, I don't see any town moving forward. And if that happens, you know, the no action solution, I think we'll start to see significant and fairly severe degradation of the basin and embayments within 5 to 10 years, and it'll have a significant impact on the economy. So, you know, I don't see any good news coming out of the lawsuit. I think there'll be some more discussions from the county to the towns on that issue. But the best thing that we can do right now is exactly what we are doing, which is to sort of get together, try to build consensus around a solution that is sensitive to the unique situation that we face on the Cape, and to look for the regulatory flexibility to implement that. And so that's what we're going to try to do, so that if we are joined or sued at some point here, we will have a plan and a solution that we think is doable and fair, and the least costly plan that we can come up with.
Mr. Short.
Last evening, the Orleans Water Alliance and the taxpayers, the Orleans Taxpayers Association, made a presentation to the selectmen on wastewater. The Taxpayers Association is setting up a meeting now to bring in the principal organizations and get them together in an attempt to try and get some sort of consensus. And then the OWA, the Water Alliance, is supporting that effort and as is are a number of other organizations in town trying to do exactly the same thing. But I think there's going to be a rather difficult battle that will ensue as a result of the attitudes that are going on. They have come a long way, the opposition to the work that has been done. They've come a long way from where they were originally, which was basically they wanted to cut out fertilizers and they wanted to dredge, and that was going to solve the problem in some of the terminal ponds. They have now come to a point where they realize that that is not a solution. It might be one of the ingredients, but not an important one. And they're even acquiescing somewhat on their alternative systems that have been presented in the past, some of the concepts.
Thank you very much. That's a very important discussion for that we have been having and will continue to have with regard to wastewater as the next most challenging frontier, I think, facing us on Cape Cod. Thank you for those questions and comments. Anything further from the members with regard to the executive director's report? Mr. Harris.
Shut me up if I should.
I will.
Okay. I had the opportunity to attend a wastewater presentation that was held in Sandwich. And I know that we're doing all of the possible things we can as far as we are concerned on the Cape. But the thing that I find lacking, and it's not because of anyone in this organization, but I think we need a combination of other resources here on the Cape to talk about wastewater, and it should be recorded and presented to the public almost on a continuous loop. Because I must say that when I was at this presentation, I was sitting here kicking myself saying I should have brought my little camera and recorded it, because the executive director put on the presentation that covered all the things that basically should in fact be covered. But certainly the what's in it for me, for everybody that lives on this Cape, even if they don't agree with it, at least they would have seen what's in it for me and also understand the impact, and also realize that there's not a particular agenda established by the commission, because subsequent to that, and also when I attended the SMART summit, the Cape, I had people saying, oh, you know, the guys are working out something that's $8 billion and so on. It's the furthest thing from the truth, but we need to have this information put out so that people who don't have a very long memory, which is many of us here, but also understand that there's something that's in the process that we need to have people to start to pay some attention to. Good information is, I think that it's very effective. The problem is that if it doesn't penetrate the brain barrier, then it doesn't go anywhere. And, you know, I looked at what was going on there in Sandwich, and I thought, if there were as many people at the at that meeting as were at the town meeting, we'd have had a lot of informed people, because it was a presentation that said clearly, this is what's in it for you. You now need to sit down and decide to do something rather than constantly being in a process of finding fault, but trying to find a solution and also get on the train of the various organizations that are trying to resolve this issue. So I guess I didn't say anything to put this gentleman in jeopardy, because he's working very hard at it, and the staff are working very hard at it. But I just think that our media is not doing a good job, and our public media, the PEG stations that we have, that's not being done very good, very well. But also there's something we can be doing, and I think that with a little small camera, you can record these things, and if he doesn't like what's been said on it, he can always edit it out. But the truth is that, you know, he talks about what has to be done, and we need to do as much as we possibly can to have people very knowledgeable and aware of what it is that's coming down the road. Because this whole thing, perhaps you've heard this story about a frog sitting in a little pan and the temperature of the water being raised 1 degree. And that really is the situation that's happening here. But you see it, it's evidenced by what's happening in the bays and what's happening in the ponds and the lakes. It's really what's happening here. And one day, we're going to wake up, certainly our, the people who are replacing us, going to wake up and find out that they can't stop it anymore. It's too late. So that's my pontification for the day.
And thank you for that, Mr. Harris. Absolutely. I think it's, if I might editorialize for 10 seconds, it's, we are in the nexus of that conversation on a regular basis and have been for some time. And I think sometimes it's amazing to some of us to know that there are folks on the Cape who have not heard the message or don't quite haven't gathered the substance of the information yet. But it's a wake-up call for us to remember that we have to continue to spread that particular message around the Cape, because it is extraordinarily significant for our quality of life, our economic development, and our environmental protection going forward. But that being said, I will continue on unless there's anything further. And we could also come back to address this at final comments as well. We do have two sets of minutes from April 12, 2012 and April 26, 2012 that we need to vote upon. I trust the members have had a chance to take a look at those, and I'll take those separately. I'd like to hear a motion to accept the minutes from April 12, 2012. I've heard a motion made and seconded. Is there discussion, comments, adjustments that need to be made with regard to the minutes of April 12th? Hearing none, then I will call for a vote. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions?
Aye.
Abstentions noted. I declare the motion passes. Now on to April 26th minutes. I would hear.
Move the minutes of April 26th.
Second. I've heard a motion and a second. Is there discussion, commentary, or changes that need to be made to those minutes? Hearing none, I'll call for a vote. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Abstentions noted. I declare the motion passes. Thank you very much. And now we move on into our public hearing with regard to 3 Main Street, the Chatham final hearing with regard to the DuPont residence. This is a decision that's continued from the May 17th, 2012 meeting, and I would like to welcome our staff presentation, Ms. Enos.
Elizabeth Enos for the record, regulatory officer with the commission. I'll be presenting on 3 Main Street in Chatham. Before I begin, I would ask the subcommittee to approve a set of minutes from May 31st, 2012.
We do have those minutes. Members of the subcommittee. I've heard a motion and a second from the members of the subcommittee. Subcommittees only, if there is any further commentary or questions to those minutes. Here are those now. Seeing none, I'll call for a vote. All those in favor of ratifying those minutes, please signify by saying aye. Subcommittee members only.
Aye.
All those opposed? Any abstentions? I declare the motion passes. I declare it was a unanimous vote. Thank you, Ms. Enos.
Thank you. Okay, I will be going over the existing setting, the proposed project, a procedural overview, and then I will pass it over to Sarah Korjeff for the subcommittee's findings and conditions related to the project, and then I will review the criteria for approval. The project is located at 3 Main Street in Chatham. It is within the Chatham's Old Village Historic District, listed on the National Register of Historic Places in December 2001. The district encompasses approximately 95 acres east and southeast of Chatham's Main Street commercial area, framed by mill ponds and the Atlantic coastline. The district's period of growth and development was during the mid-1800s, when it served as the commercial center of town and reflected the economic prosperity and population growth that followed the area's success in maritime industries. The house is located on a triangular lot located at the intersection of Silverleaf Avenue and Main Street. The John and Benjamin Mallows House is a three-quarter Cape house built circa 1815 and was located across the street from its current location, where a tennis club now stands. The house was moved in 1892 to its present site, but oriented towards Silverleaf Avenue. In 1938, the house was placed onto a new foundation at its current location, reoriented to face Main Street and the Atlantic beyond, and a rear L was added to the house. In 1970, the current owner's family added the garage and breezeway. Proposed changes to the historic Cape involve replacing the picture window on the front facade with a bay window and removing the 20th century chimney on the west side. The existing side L will be enlarged by approximately 4 feet in the rear, extending the existing roof pitch several feet higher. The applicant proposes to replace and expand the rear L, adding a new master bathroom and kitchen as one-story elements on the west side of the house, and adding a new one-story sitting room on the east side. The existing breezeway and attached garage will be demolished and replaced with a new attached two-car garage and entry hall, and a playroom will be added on the east side. A new deck is also proposed between the new playroom and the sitting room. This DRI was referred by Chatham's Historical Commission on February 27, 2012. The application was received on March 5th, and it is a DRI pursuant to sections 2AIA and 3A of the Commission's enabling regulations as a substantial alteration of a building, structure, or site listed on the National Register of Historic Places outside of a municipal historic district or outside the Old Kings Highway Regional Historic District. Pursuant to section 7C82B, for projects involving historic properties referred under section 3A above, the Commission shall waive application of minimum performance standards other than those under the Heritage Preservation and Community Character section of the Regional Policy Plan. This DRI was opened by a hearing officer on April 26, 2012. The site visit and public hearing were held on May 17th, and the subcommittee meetings were held on May 17th and May 31st, 2012. At the final subcommittee meeting, the subcommittee recommended approval of the proposed project with conditions. Now I'll hand it over to Sarah Korjeff to deal with the community character findings of the decision.
Good afternoon. For the record, Sarah Korjeff, a historic preservation specialist with the Commission. And I want to just review the significant findings, which all relate to historic preservation community character for this project. So beginning with finding HPCC 1, which establishes the historic significance of the three-quarter cape on this property, which is an early 19th century example of a Cape Cod house, specifically a three-quarter cape, and one that has retained its original form and historic and architectural features. Finding HPCC 2 identifies the building's key character-defining features, and that's the three-quarter cape form with the asymmetrical facade, its modest size, and its close orientation to the road, which is typical of the historic district in which it's located. Finding 2 continues on to state that the proposal retains these character-defining features consistent with standard HPCC 1.1. Specifically, the cape remains prominent as the tallest part of the building, and the original mass or form is clearly visible, even with the proposed additions to the side and the rear of the structure. Finding number 3 states that the proposal does not remove or alter any distinguishing original stylistic features or examples of skilled craftsmanship, again, citing consistency with standard HPCC 1.1. And staff notes simply that there was already a change to the front facade of the building in terms of the original cape windows had been replaced by a picture window. Liz had cited that earlier in the presentation. Finding 4 addresses the design of the proposed additions, stating that they use traditional materials, roof slopes, and a combination of 1- and 2-story massings to ensure that they're compatible with the three-quarter cape form. Also, that these additions are of the appropriate scale. While they do increase the massing of the building overall, the setbacks and the lower elevation on which most of them are located prevent a strong impact on the historic structure, and thus compliance with standards HPCC 1.1 and HPCC 2.4. Finding number 5 acknowledges that the Chatham Old Village Historic District is a cultural landscape, but notes specifically that the proposed project does not alter any of the distinguishing original features in that cultural landscape, and thus the project complies with standards HPCC 1.2 and HPCC 2.3. And finally, I want to point to finding number 7, which addresses letters that were submitted by the Chatham Historical Commission and the Massachusetts Historical Commission, both expressing some concern about the scale of the proposed additions to the historic structure and the possibility that they might overwhelm the historic three-quarter cape building. This finding states that after careful consideration, the commission finds that the proposed additions would not diminish the historic significance of the three-quarter cape structure or of the historic district surrounding, and they would also not affect the National Register eligibility of either the structure or the surrounding historic district. Let's see. Then moving on to the key conditions, there are not many conditions placed on this decision. The two primary ones, though, are that prior to issuance of a building permit for development, the applicant shall seek and obtain a special permit from the Chatham Zoning Board of Appeals, and also that any changes in plans, any deviation from the proposed project, shall require approval from the Cape Cod Commission through its modification process under pursuant to the enabling regulations. I'd be happy to answer any questions regarding findings and conditions, but otherwise I'll return the presentation to Liz Enos.
The criteria for approval for any DRI are that the commission shall approve or approve with conditions a DRI and shall allow a municipal agency to grant a development permit for a proposed DRI if the commission finds after a public hearing that the probable benefit from the proposed development is greater than the probable detriment, that the proposed development is consistent with the RPP and the local comprehensive plan of the municipality in which the proposed development is located. The proposed development is consistent with municipal development bylaws, or if inconsistent, the inconsistency is necessary to enable a substantial segment of the population to secure adequate opportunities for housing, conservation, environmental protection, education, recreation of balanced economic growth. And finally, if the proposed development is located in whole or in part within a designated DCPC, it is consistent with the regulations approved or adopted by the Commission pursuant to Section 11 of the Act. We received written correspondence from Terrence Whalen, the principal planner for the town of Chatham, dated May 10, 2012, in which he notes that in order to comply with the local zoning, the applicant will need a special permit from the ZBA. That is why we have that key condition in the decision that requires that special permit prior to approval. We also received correspondence from the town planner that it is not located in a DCPC, and also that the town of Chatham does not have a commission-certified local comprehensive plan. Finally, the subcommittee recommends approval of the proposed project with conditions and approval of the draft decision. So if you have any questions, we'd be happy to answer them.
Thank you very much, Elizabeth and Sarah. Before we move forward with the applicant's presentation and then public testimony, I will ask for any members who are looking to speak to the matter to rise now and be sworn in keeping with our adjudicatory process. Please repeat after me. I state your name.
I, John.
Do hereby swear to tell the truth.
Do hereby swear to tell the truth.
The whole truth. And nothing but the truth. Thank you very much for your compliance there. I will now ask the applicant if they have a presentation to make to us at this time.
Just briefly, thank you. Good afternoon, Jonathan Eidman for the record, for Jim and Andrea DuPont, we're in the second row. I also have Sam Streibert with me today, who is the project architect. Elizabeth and Sarah went through a good deal of the description of the property, so I'll just speak to you a little bit from the DuPont's perspective. The goal of the DuPonts here, who have owned the property for 40 years, is to preserve the original three-quarter significant cape portion of the house, circa 1850, while expanding the living area by altering and adding to the later portions of the house, which are primarily mid and late 20th century additions. It's interesting here that Andrea's mother, Marie Griffin, is really part of the historical context of this property as well. She was a noted Chatham watercolor artist. She painted at the property, and she taught at the property painting. I'd suggest to you what are proposed are reasonable changes and updates to the property, which balance the DuPont's needs, goals, and desires with the value of the surrounding Old Village National Register District. This is a visible and important property in the district. However, the DuPonts have been committed throughout what has now been a five-year process to recognize the importance of the property in their proposed design. They plan to spend increasingly more time at this property in their retirement with their extended family and their grandchildren. Much of the existing rear later added portions of the house proposed to be reconfigured are currently unsafe, poorly designed, and really lack further useful life and function. The proposed design has been developed with an eye towards aesthetics, but also for a function of a multi-generational house and for multi-generation family activities, and of course their own day-to-day living there. The economics of this proposal, including the functional additions, allow for the significant historical portion of this building, which is the 1815 three-quarter cape, to be preserved while also allowing them to have a functional house to live in. So I really think it's a win-win here. And the addition is an integral part of allowing that 1815 significant portion of the house to be preserved. As Elizabeth went through, I would concur, I would suggest that this proposal meets the concerns of the Act and meets the concerns of the regulation in terms of approval. The proposal meets the minimum performance standards of the RPP. In terms of local regulations and the local comprehensive plan, the proposal meets the local comprehensive plan and is consistent with local regulations, and that the proposal will need a special permit from the Chatham Zoning Board of Appeals. The probable benefits outweigh any probable detriments, principally because, again, this project allows the significant 1815 portion of the house to be preserved in its entirety. The fundamental question, I think, really before the Cape Cod Commission is the same question as existed when the property was referred, and that is, do the alterations jeopardize the property's listing as a contributing structure in the National Register District? I would tell you that the alterations do not jeopardize the property's listing as a contributing structure. And one way to look at that would be, if there was no National Register District today and these alterations were made, would this property be ineligible? And I think reason would be hard strained to come up with the fact that this would not be eligible for listing, especially considering that the 1815 portion of the house is being retained and preserved, and much of the house was listed as a contributing structure with 20th century additions, including mid-20th century and almost 1970s additions. This fits into the National Register District. The district is marked by buildings spanning 300 years. There's greatly varied architecture in this district. The ages and sizes of buildings are greatly varied. And there are innumerable instances of repurposed buildings, relocated buildings, and significantly altered buildings, which did not prevent other buildings listing as contributing structures in the district. And so part of the charm of this area are the alterations of buildings, seeing their change over time, seeing their repurposing, and seeing how buildings can be of varied sizes and varied architecture, though fit into a consistent historic district. So I'd ask you to adopt the unanimous recommendations for approval by both the staff and by the subcommittee. And of course, I'd be happy to answer any questions you have along with Sam, project architect, or the DuPonts. So, thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Iveman. Is there anything further that wanted to be added on the applicant's side, or do we stand on the presentation?
I think we stand unless you have specific questions about design, in which case Sam could go through some of those questions.
Thank you very much. Then at this time, I will open it up to my fellow commission members to pursue questions. Mr. Knight.
Just a point of clarification for staff. I think we need to swear the staff in for the testimony they gave, and if they're going to get any questions to follow. So it's just all, there's no question of the process. So that's all.
I have no problem with that. That's an excellent point made. So at this time, I will ask our staff members to also rise and participate in the adjudicatory process required. Please repeat after me. I state your name.
I, Sarah Borges.
Do hereby solemnly swear.
Do hereby solemnly swear.
To tell the truth.
To tell the truth.
The whole truth.
The whole truth.
And nothing but the truth.
Nothing but the truth.
Thank you very much for swearing, and thank you, Mr. Knight, for pointing out that adjudicatory matter. Any questions with regard to the applicant presentation or the project at hand before us?
Mr. Chairman.
Ms. O'Keefe.
Are you going to hear other testimony? Because I saw one other person, and then can we then ask questions or make comments after everyone has been heard?
We certainly can do that. If there aren't any questions from the commission members at this point in time, we certainly would come back to that after hearing other testimony.
Having served on the subcommittee, my colleagues that on the commission may want to hear from those of us that actually walked the site, took a site visit, held the public hearing, and then two subsequent subcommittee meetings.
And that's absolutely appropriate and entirely fine. If there are no questions from the commission members at this point in time, I will ask if there is any public comment with regard to the matter, and we normally ask for public comment in the following order. I'll invite any federal, state, or local officials who have to speak to this matter to approach the podium. And please identify yourself for the record.
Good afternoon. I'm Bob Oliver, chairman of the Chatham Historical Commission. I'm here solely to represent the commission with respect to any questions that may come up relative to its decision. But I also want to take this opportunity to thank the Cape Cod Commission staff and the subcommittee and the commission, the full commission, for your assistance with this application. I've been on the Historical Commission, the local Historic Commission, for 8 years. This is one of the most difficult decisions, most difficult applications we've had, and we thank you for your participation, assistance, and help in this regard. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Oliver. Is there any other further public testimony from federal, state, or local officials? Seeing none, any other general comments from other members of the public concerned? And again, seeing none. I would now like to revisit commission members to see if there's any questions or clarifications, comments by either the subcommittee in particular or the membership at large. Ms. Brookshire?
I have two questions. What affected the Chatham not having a commission-certified long-range comprehensive plan, local comprehensive plan, have on this process, in the reviewing process? What might have been different?
Commission counsel, do you want to take a stab at that?
Good afternoon, Jessica Wilgus. The net effect of that is simply that that's not something that you have to hold after in terms of looking at for a standard of review. That's not something that you have to examine to determine compliance with in making your decision today.
And then my last question is, what effect could the Zoning Board of Appeals have on this project? Best case and worst case scenarios, I guess.
Sarah Korjeff again, preservation specialist. My understanding is that the Zoning Board of Appeals is reviewing this project in terms of the size and scale of the proposed additions. They will not be questioning the direct impact on the historic structure, which has been the focus of the Cape Cod Commission review. But based on the underlying zoning, they could determine that the proposed additions and alterations or additions to the building exceed a scale that they're comfortable having in that neighborhood, and so they could actually require that the additions be redesigned at a smaller scale.
That answers your question. Further questions, Mr. Roy?
I believe that the plan, the footprint of the building shows that it's intruding into the setback. of the property, and that's why they have to go to the Zoning Board of Appeals to get approval to intrude into that setback. Is that correct?
That's one of the unique things the Chatham zoning bylaw allows. When there's a non-conforming property, further encroachments into setbacks are allowed. But this would be going anyway because there are improvements even up to the non-conforming setback. So I think I've heard some figure that 75 or 80% of properties in Chatham are non-conforming anyway. So most properties in Chatham that seek alterations go to the Board of Appeals in Chatham. Yeah. Does that answer the question?
Yes, it does.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Knight.
Mr. Chairman, a lot of these thoughts in the process came to the committee, and that wasn't our purview in this. Our purview was the historic part of it, and the town will take care of their part. We had to take care of ours. So we're very clear on what we needed to do, and as a committee member on the subcommittee, I felt we did a good job and do endorse the passing of this.
Thank you very much, Mr. Knight. You're absolutely correct. As chairman of that particular subcommittee, we did speak to that matter, tried to focus in on the conversation as to what was within our purview and why was the matter before us. And really, the essence of this issue revolves around the discretionary referral that came from the Chatham Historical Commission because this structure was within the historical delineation within the town. We do have that authority to review, but again, it's with regard to that historical nature of the property. If I'm not correct, please correct me, Ms. Enos.
Just a point of clarification, it was a mandatory referral, not a discretionary.
Thank you very much for that clarification. I saw another question, I think, from Ms. O'Keefe.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just so that it's in part of the minutes, I think that it's important to note the hard work of the committee and that we worked completely within the criteria for the DRI. I think it was important to note that we heard that in 1970 there were updates, and this is the same family. This is a private residence that they're looking to bring safety in the changes in the dwelling as it exists now. And I think it was Austin Knight that brought out that there will now be two staircases and not one. Certainly that a house that was built 200 years ago does not fit in, just not only for the safety but just for the comfort and to be able to live within a dwelling with which a family from generations now owns. I think that the most important thing for me was walking around in the neighborhood to see other homes that had similar architectural changes, and that having walked the property and the neighborhood and understanding that it's a corner lot, that the lighthouse is one of the abutters, the main street is the second, the third is another street, I forget the name of it, and the back part, and also that within the architectural drawings was that the lovely trees and habitat in the frontage would not alter the view, that they have a magnificent view there. And also, if someone was walking by or driving by, that none of that was going to be changed. To elaborate a little bit more on how that one staircase, it's a very narrow staircase that is 1815, and there are three bedrooms in which would be an attic area, and they're not going up to the 35 height that they could. It's remaining at 22 feet, so that if there was an incident where, you know, old wiring or something catastrophic happened, the family would not be able to get out of that dwelling as it exists today. And I thought that the second thing that impressed me was I believe there were numerous times that there were numerous changes in both in walking the property and also in looking at the changes in the dwellings of how many times that each time that the applicant went before the historical or the planning that they capitulated, and it's been a lengthy time. So I just wanted to point out, and although it may look huge on that lot of land, it really is not. So for the safety of the family, and that they can also live with comfortable with their children and their grandchildren, and I think that was a big factor for the subcommittee to unanimously vote to recommend under the DRI criteria. Thank you.
Other questions or commentary from members of the commission? I'll take the opportunity to elaborate just a little bit on Joanne's comment there with regard to the emergency and safety concerns. We heard testimony from one of the abutters who was in favor of the alterations and modifications of the dwelling, and they had explained to us a situation where years ago someone needed to be transported from that dwelling, from that building, and at the time the doorways and the stairways were so narrow and constrained that it didn't allow emergency personnel to access the property properly. They ended up, if I recall correctly from the testimony we heard from the abutter, that the person who was injured was put onto a kitchen chair or a dining room chair of some sort, carried out physically through the narrow stairways and doorways out to where they could then be put onto a stretcher. And I know that particular testimony was important to members of the subcommittee to know that these upgrades and updates would also help improve the accessibility for emergency purposes to the property. Mr. Short.
I cannot understand how the DuPonts have lived in that house for all these years. It is such a hodgepodge, and it needs desperately, for not only safety's sake, but just for livability's sake, to be altered to get a better flow within the house. So I would definitely support moving forward with this thing. And also, the important part of this is that the Zoning Board of Appeals will ultimately have the last say in all of this. We're only interested in the historic preservation portion of it, and now it goes to the Zoning Board of Appeals, which I think is hopefully you're going to have an easier time with them.
That's a very important point to note, that regardless of the outcome here, even if this particular application passes by our body, it still is stopping at the ZBA in Chatham, and the local municipality can certainly subject the application to their scrutiny and their regulations as well. Are there any other further discussion, comments, questions from the members? Anything further in closing from the applicant or from anyone in the public? Staff? See none. Then I would entertain a motion to approve the DRI with conditions for the proposed alteration of the residential structure, but maybe I might not be.
Before you do that, I would ask that you close the hearing in the record.
Ah, yes. Before we can vote, we do have to have a motion to close the hearing in the record. I've heard a motion and a second. Is there any discussion with regard to closing the hearing and the record on this matter? Hearing none, I'll ask for a vote. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? I declare the motion passes and declare it was unanimous vote. Now, am I in order in asking for a motion with regard to the project? Thank you very much. I would like to hear a motion to approve the DRI with conditions for the proposed alteration of the residential structure located at 3 Main Street in Chatham, Massachusetts. I've heard a motion and a second. Now, any further discussion with regard to the motion? Seeing none, I'll call for a vote. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? I declare the motion passes. I declare it was a unanimous vote. Congratulations. We have one other matter. I would also accept, before we move forward in the agenda, a motion to
Michael.
Approve the draft DRI decision
okay.
for 3 Main Street in Chatham as submitted.
Second.
I've heard a motion and a second. Any conversation or discussion with regard to that? Hearing none, I'll call for a vote. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? I declare the motion passes. I declare that was a unanimous vote. And that is the conclusion of 3 Main Street. Thank you. We have other business now. I have here a notice of a withdrawal of the Provincetown Airport Capital Project Improvements Plan for commission review.
Excuse me, Mr. Chair, you have another agenda item. It's the election of officers.
All right, then we will move on to that matter of business. Next, the election of new officers. The chairman of the nominating committee was not able to be here, but Mr. Short, I might call upon you to present the slate of officers for 2012.
Thank you very much. I nominate, the committee nominates John Harris as chair, Jack McCormick as vice chair, and Richard Roy as secretary.
Is that being made as a motion? I've heard a motion that the nominations be closed. Is there a second to that motion? I've heard a second now. All in favor of that motion to close nominations? All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Declare the motion passes, declares unanimous vote. We have the slate presented before us as read by Mr. Short. I would ask if there is a vote to approve the slate. Thank you very much. There's a motion and a second. Any further discussion with regard to the slate of officers going forward for 2012 as presented? Hearing none, I'll call for a vote. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposition? Any abstentions? I declare the motion passes. I declare as unanimous vote. Congratulations, 2012 officers. Now we have the withdrawal of Provincetown Airport Capital Improvements Plan from Commission Review.
Andrea Adams is on her way up here, but I'll just cover this quickly. You do have in your packets a notification of withdrawal from the Provincetown Airport.
Please state your name and title for the record.
Chrissy Senatore, Chief Regulatory Officer. My apologies. The Provincetown Airport is a project that was undergoing joint review with the Commission and MEPA. They are in the process of putting together their DRI application, and they are simply needing a little bit more time, so they're just requesting a withdrawal of their application at this time. They do intend to refile. There are no local permits pending. And so we just suggest that you formalize their withdrawal in the form of a motion.
To accept the request from the Provincetown for withdrawal.
Second. Excellent. So I've heard a motion then to accept the withdrawal of the Provincetown Airport Capital Improvements Plan from the Development of Regional Impact without prejudice. The motion was made and seconded. Is there any discussion with regard to that motion? Seeing none, I'll call for a vote. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposition? Any abstentions? Declare the motion passes. Declare as unanimous
Thank
vote.
You.
Thank you. And then lastly, I believe we are out of business, and it is the time of our meeting where we typically entertain comments from commission members.
I don't want to upstage anyone else, but I think that until you serve as a chair of this committee, then you don't realize how much work is involved and along with the other officers. And so without stealing anybody else's thunder, I'll let them comment on the good job of this year's officers. But the public should know exactly how much work, how many committees that, and the other duties that go with an election of offices. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Knight?
I was going to say the same thing, and thank you, Michael, for all your work and the other members of the executive committee.
Thank you very much, and absolutely, I would be remiss if I didn't thank Mr. Graham from Truro and Ms. Taylor from Brewster for all of their years of service and the hard work they've put on in alongside me, and I'm sure we will be succeeded by an ably and talented bunch. So look forward to working with you in 2012. Is there any other comments from members? That's absolutely in order. Is there a second to that?
Second.
Okay, all those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Thank you very much.